Data bank, commence recording. This is General Straker of the World Security Service. In this briefing, I'll be discussing the operational capabilities of the Shadow Moonbase Interceptor, which played a vital role in the defense of Earth throughout the alien conflict of the 1980s. The Moonbase Interceptor was a single-person spacecraft and the first line of defense against the constant threat of UFO attacks in the latter half of the 20th century. Developed from the original X-1 prototype space interceptor, the craft was 42 feet long and 20 feet wide. Three interceptors were stationed on emergency standby in the hangar bay below Shadow's moon base. When the Space Intruder Detector satellite confirmed a UFO sighting, the moon base controller would order an immediate launch. Upon hearing the order, the three duty astronauts proceeded to their launch chutes. When the astronauts had taken up position in their craft, the hangar bays were depressurized and the interceptors raised towards the exit hatches on hydraulic platforms. The hatches retracted and the platforms locked into place. The lead astronaut in Interceptor 1 engaged the motors in his craft, guided it off the pad, and set course for the designated sector, relayed by SIB. Interceptors 2 and 3 followed their leader and assumed an attack formation. UFOs typically approached Earth at velocities well in excess of the speed of light, or SOL. This made it impossible for the sublight interceptors to engage them directly using traditional space combat tactics. Instead, a complex firing solution was calculated to ensure the best chance of destroying the approaching UFO. As the three shadow craft proceeded on course, Sid continued to report on the UFO's speed and trajectory, calculating precise information for each interceptor's onboard missile control computer. Timing information was relayed to the interceptors by the moon base commander, and the missile program was completed and locked in by the astronauts. The moment the opposing craft had closed to the optimum calculated firing point, the interceptors launched their missiles. Each missile split into 10 smaller atomic charges, detonating simultaneously over a wide area. Successful detonation was confirmed by SID, followed by the moonbase commander advising whether or not the UFO had been destroyed. If the enemy made it through the interceptor's missile attack unscathed, the shadowcraft would return to moonbase and the UFO's destruction would be left to Shadow Earth forces. However, if the UFO was damaged and forced to drop to sublight speed, the interceptors may have had a chance to pursue the craft if its trajectory brought it within range. In the event that this happened, the interceptors would break formation and engage the UFO with their close-range autocannons. These secondary weapons were seldom used, but were highly effective, provided the interceptor could score a direct hit on the damaged UFO. Although instances of close-range combat were rare, the risks associated with such encounters were high, as there was no way to know if a UFO's weaponry was still functional. At maximum speed, a shadow interceptor was more than likely to be outmaneuvered by a UFO, even one that had sustained moderate damage. It was a risk that all shadow astronauts were trained for. In exceptional circumstances, it was possible for a single interceptor to be rearmed at Moonbase. During one operation, the interceptors engaged a fleet of UFOs with the assistance of Shadow's lunar defenses. After all three craft fired their missiles, two interceptors were able to distract the attacking alien craft, while the third interceptor was rearmed and launched from Moonbase under a hail of covering fire from the Shadow Lunar Launchers. Today, such a vehicle may be considered impractical. But back then, in the heat of the crisis we faced, it was one of our greatest assets. This concludes the briefing. Databank cease recording.